It has been moved and seconded that the resolution that read will be received and adopted. Are you ready for the question? All in favor, let it be known by standing on your feet. Started a bus protest which literally electrified the nation. And that was the day when we decided that we were not going to take segregated buses any longer. And you know, when we planned the bus boycott, we said if we could just get about 50 or 60% of the Negroes of Montgomery not to ride buses, this would be an effective boycott. I think that whole day we found 8 Negroes on the buses. And from that day on, that boycott was more than 99.9% effective. I remember that Monday morning when I was subpoenaed to be in court, the chief defender. Many things ran through my mind. And I started thinking about the people. All day long trying to think of something to say to the people. Finally, I tried to talk. My words were fumbling a bit. Let us fight passionately and unrelentingly for the goal of justice. Let's be sure that our hands are clean in the struggle. Let us never fight with falsehood and violence and hate and malice, but always fight with love so that when the day comes that the walls of segregation is completely crumbled in Montgomery, we will be able to live with people as our brothers and sisters.
Dr. King, I'd like to come back to you now. The superintendent of police of Chicago, Mr. O.W. Wilson, said the other day that your civil rights tactics have aroused hatred among Chicago white residents and are hampering the Negroes' progress. What's your answer to that?
Well, my answer is that this is totally erroneous. Our civil rights efforts have not aroused hatred. They have revealed hatred that already existed. There is no doubt about the fact that there are many latent hostilities existing within certain white groups in the North. And what has happened now is that these latent hostilities have come out in the open, and I don't think you can blame the civil rights movement for that. Certainly no one would blame a physician for using his instruments and his skills and his know-how to reveal to a patient that he has cancer. Indeed, one would praise a physician for having the wisdom and the judgment and the power to do that. Now, we have only revealed in Chicago that there is a blatant social hate-filled cancer, and we haven't said even that it's in its terminal state. We feel that it's curable, that it can be cured, but there is no doubt about the fact that the hate is here. We didn't create it. We merely exposed it and brought it to the surface.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. This is what we are faced with. And this is a reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
It disappeared.
Wait a minute. It didn't disappear. You might forget, Martin Luther King was assassinated in April. The Poor People's Campaign was supposed to go to Washington in April.
Mm-hmm.
So the organization that mobilized it was essentially decapitated and thrown into chaos about 3 weeks before it was supposed to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Those organizations were being, as I said, once the Civil Rights Acts were completed, that was it.
Mm-hmm.
Government was through with us. They're not interested in restructuring. There has never been any interest in restructuring the economy for the benefit of the poor. I don't know where you're going to talk about the bonus army, go back to Shays' Rebellion. I mean, this is like the no-no. You know, this is a capitalist society. It's built on inequality and avarice in many ways.
Mm-hmm.
Even when pressed by the demands of inner truth, men do not easily assume the task of opposing their government's policy, especially in time of war. And I knew that I could never again raise my voice against the violence of the oppressed in the ghettos without having first spoken clearly to the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today, my own government. What do they think as we test out our latest weapons on them? Just as the Germans tested out new medicine and new tortures in the concentration camps of Europe. Now there is little left to build on save bitterness. We are met by deep but understandable mistrust. To speak for them is to explain this lack of confidence in Western words, and especially their distrust of American intentions now. The world now demands a maturity of America that we may not be able to achieve. This way of settling differences is not just. A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death. Somehow this madness must cease. We must stop now. I speak as one who loves America, to the leaders of our own nation. The great initiative in this war is ours. The initiative to stop it must be ours.
Gandhi, Dr. King, dramatized and defined the technique of nonviolence, and yet he also said that the only alternative to fear is violence, and that if that were the alternative, he would have to choose violence. Do you subscribe to that judgment of Gandhi, or would you disavow violence under any condition?
Well, I think I would have to somewhat interpret Gandhi at this point. I don't think he was setting forth violence as an alternative. I think he was emphasizing or rather trying to refute an all too prevalent fallacy, and that is that the persons who use the method of nonviolence are actually the weak persons who don't have the weapons of violence, persons who are afraid. And I think that is what Gandhi was attempting to refute. Now, in that instance, I would agree with Gandhi that if the only alternative to violence, to fear, is violence and vice versa, then I would say fight. But it isn't the only alternative. And that is the one point that Gandhi was trying to bring out. It seems to me that there are three ways that oppressed people can deal with their oppression.
What are they, Dr. King?
Well, one is to rise up in open violence, in physical violence. And some persons have used that method, persons who have been oppressed. But I think the danger of that method is its futility. I feel that violence creates many more social problems than it solves.
May I interrupt you there, Dr. King? There are today certainly people who are forced to endure a kind of injustice. that neither you nor even Gandhi in his time had ever seen. For example, would you regard the martyrs of Hungary's rebellion a year ago as misguided men and having used violence?
I admire freedom fighters wherever they are, but I still believe that nonviolence is the strongest approach. I think that would apply to the Hungarian situation also. I don't think it's limited to a particular locality. I think it should apply in every situation in the world where individuals seek to break loose from the bondage of colonialism or from some totalitarian regime or from the system which we confront in America.
You truly believe then that nonviolence is the sole, the universal answer to injustice and oppression?
Very definitely. Very definitely. I feel that nonviolence, organized nonviolent resistance is the most powerful weapon that oppressed people can use in breaking loose from the bondage of oppression. Now, the other method that one might use is that of resignation or acquiescence. But I think that is just as bad as violence, because non-cooperation with evil is as much a moral obligation as is cooperation with good.
You make a difference, a distinction between passive resistance and nonviolent resistance, is that it?
Well, I think that can be something of a semantical problem. If passive resistance means just passively accepting violence or injustice, if it means cowardice and stagnant passivity, then there is a difference, because nonviolent resistance does resist. It is dynamically active. It is passive physically, but it is strongly active spiritually.
In a sense, would you regard it as moving into the Christian philosophy too? You mean the doctrine of turn the other cheek to regard as positive rather than passive?
I think it is positive. I think very definitely, if it is used properly and accepted with a proper attitude, it is a very strong method. It is a method of the strong man, not the weak man.
Dr. King, the editor of the local newspaper here proposed an editorial the other day that I ask you to reconcile, as he put it, your passive resistance philosophy with your satisfaction that you've expressed very clearly over the use of bayonet force in the Little Rock situation. Well, I'll put that question to you. What is your answer to this editor, sir?
Well, I might say that I did back the president in his action in Little Rock, Arkansas. I think it is quite regrettable and unfortunate that young high school students have to go to school under the protection of federal troops. But I think it is even more unfortunate that a public official, through irresponsible actions, leaves the President of the United States with no other alternative. So I did back the President, and I sent him a telegram commending him. Now, your main question is, and the question of the editor of our local newspaper here, is how does this jibe with my whole philosophy of nonviolence?
How does it?
I believe firmly in nonviolence, as I have already said. But at the same time, I am not an anarchist. Now, some pacifists are anarchists, following Tolstoy. But I don't go that far. I believe in the intelligent use of police force. I think one who believes in nonviolence must recognize the dimensions of evil within human nature. And there is a danger that one can indulge in a sort of superficial optimism, thinking man is all good. Man does not only have the greater capacity for goodness, but there is also the potential for evil. And I think of that throughout my whole philosophy, and I try to be realistic at that point. So that I believe in the intelligent use of police force. And I think that is all we have in Little Rock. It's not an army fighting against a nation or a race of people. It is just police force seeking to enforce the law of the land.
All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper. if I lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country. Maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that over there. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. And so just as I say we aren't gonna let any dogs or water hoses turn us around, we aren't going to let any injunction turn us around. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.